give me of a home far beyond the skies. They tell me of a home far away, or they tell me of a home when the storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Oh, the land of cloudless days. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a home when the storm clouds rise.
Thank you. Jake, you know what time it is? It's Critter 30. That's what time it is, Jake. Our first Critter song of the evening is going to be one about a dog. That's how this is going to go down, folks. This is a song that come to find out, my aunt said she grew up singing. I never heard of it before until I had a very long conversation with a gentleman at the mission there in Jeff City after a show one night. He told me that he had the perfect Critter song for us to play. And I asked him which one it was, and he said, "You know the one that's doing from the Western." And that was the end of his description of the song. I asked him what Western, he said, "The Western." I asked him questions. Said, "Do you remember any of the lyrics from this song?" "It's got a harmonica in it." "And it's about a critter, and it's got no lyrics?" "No, it's got words." "Do you remember any of those words?" "No, you know the song. It's the one with the guy in the Western who plays a harmonica." This conversation carried on for about 30 minutes. And at some point, I would like to have time traveled back and just said, "I do know the one." But I did not. So I made a list of some keywords. I asked some questions about the Western. Said, "You remember anything about the movie?"
"It's got trains."
"Anything else?"
"There's horses."
Probably guns in it too.
"Yep, definitely guns. You see, you do know the one."
Finally, he said,
There's a dog, and the people's just kicking it, and the people's don't like that."
The dog, as it turns out, was the key to unlock the mystery of what the Western was. And I typed it into Google, and I hit "I'm feeling lucky." And lo and behold, it was an original Critter song from the Ozark Mountains. All that fuss for this song. I told that story one night. My aunt comes up to me and swallowed at me and said, "You don't know that song. I've been singing that song all my life." That's just how it works sometimes, right? So this is an old tune here called
"You Know the One."
Just naturally fired us. me up before the break of day. Keeps them revenue balls away. He's the best old dog he ever did see. Everywhere I go, he follows me. His voice is sweet. His name is Jim. He got the ring. I got for him. Well, every time I come to town, the boys go kicking my dog around. Makes no difference if he is a hound. You gotta stop kicking my dog around. Yeah, well, every time I come to town, the boys go kicking my dog around. Makes no difference if he is a hound. You gotta stop kicking my dog around. Yeah, well, makes no difference if he is a hound. You gotta stop kicking my dog around.
Thank y'all so much. That was
You Know the One is with the Guy.
That's what that one is. It's called Quit Kicking My Dog Around. I'm gonna switch guitars here, folks. I'm gonna switch over to the 5-string guitar. I'm gonna fail to mute. This is exactly like a 6-string guitar, folks, in every way, with one very important exception. Broke a string on it one day, didn't fix it. Liked the way it sounded, never looked back. And got it tuned up like a banjo, so it's got kind of its own thing going on here. We're gonna do one of those old kind of front porch songs that existed in that era that made Ozark music a little different from everything else, and kind of before bluegrass was a thing, before blues was a thing, before country was a thing. Thank you.
Emma Burney on the fiddle tonight, folks. Give it up.
Emma, do you know what time it is?
It's Critter O'Clock.
It's Critter O'Clock, straight up and down. That's right.
Was a mole in the ground.
wish I was a lizard in the spring.
I wish I was a lizard in the spring. I was a lizard in the spring. I could eat my chalupas.
I wish I was a lizard in the spring. Wish me was to live on the birds.
Wish me was to live.
That's a mole on the ground there. We've been playing that song for a long time. Still love it. Some of the traditional songs that we play are pretty common. A lot of people know the words to them, heard them before, you know. You got the All Flyaways and the Crawdad Holes and things like that. But you also have, you know, songs like
That One from the Western, which you already know the title of.
But finding that Mole on the Ground song was kind of fun. I remember it was a rainy day, and I got on the internet and was going through all these. There's like hours and hours of like old fiddle song field recordings and directories of old songs with very poorly transcribed music to them. And I found that song and saw the lyrics to it, and there wasn't really much in the way of chords or anything to it. And just picked up and started playing it. This next one is another song kind of like that. I found this one on an old Frank Prophet record. Banjo folks, it takes time. Tuning these things is a labor of love, but that I assure you. I got a banjo up here strung out of fishing line. That thing never goes out of tune. The first time I heard this song, it was on there. Frank Prophet was playing one of those old Appalachian banjos that had the gut strings on it, no frets. It had this really interesting sort of authentic sound to it, so. During the pandemic, I decided to dress up one of my banjos to do that sort of thing. And I ordered these real expensive strings. You know, I guess you can get gut strings still, but now it's like the nylon. It's like the nylon strings on like a nylon guitar, like a classical guitar. I'm sure some of y'all have seen those before. It's like $50 for a set of these strings. Okay, so I wait what seems like an eternity back then for Amazon to deliver it, which was 24 hours. Back in the golden era of Amazon next day delivery. these things show up, and despite having gotten to me so fast, I'm reading the instructions, I'm tuning up, and it says tune halfway, wait 48 hours, come back. I was not blessed with the particular flavor of patience that that required, so I was like, well, I'll tune up halfway, I'll wait 2 minutes, I'll come back to something. Came back, cranked on that thing. It was like a week-long process to tune up the guitar with these strings. And I was gonna give it till about 5 p.m. that day. So I did do it in sections, just like they instructed, but I converted the number of hours in between to minutes at best, if not seconds. And sure enough, one of those strings popped. And naturally, it broke, and I didn't have a replacement for it. I just spent all this money. I'm like, well, I'm going to order another. No, I'm not going to do that. And I gave up. Well, next week I was shopping at Walmart. And as it turns out, Walmart has an entire aisle of the store dedicated to Appalachian banjo strings. It's back in the camping corner, right next to the Beetle Spin Lures, folks. And they got miles of the stuff for pennies on the dollar. I came out of there, was calling every banjo player I knew on my cell phone, was like, you're not gonna believe this. I feel like I just stole this stuff. I got like 10 miles of banjo string in here. Paid about $5 for it. They got different sizes, different colors. Some of it glows in the dark. Bob, you'd like that, you know. Put it on the banjo, strung it up, waited 0 minutes, took it all the way up to the top. I had miles of the stuff. I had absolutely nothing to lose. And that's the end of the story. It feels just like the other strings, and it sounds, I think, you know, pretty much just like fishing line. What you'd imagine fishing. It's okay. It's a banjo, y'all. But I swear, I leave that thing in the van. Pull that thing out, and it's perfectly in tune. Meanwhile, the steel string stuff is a little troublesome. Help if I tuned up to the right notes too. Fair amount of operator error going on there.
Oh,
but the only song I'll ever play is "Wish That You'd Be Mine."
So much, that's an old old Appalachian song there called Cindy. We're going to do a song about food now, folks. I love food. You know, one thing I did notice, that it's just one of those weird things that I'm a sucker for everywhere I go. If I go to a restaurant and they have a patty melt on the menu, I'm unable to order anything else. I have no explanation for why. I'm not even sure I like them that much. But I saw that the food truck outside has got patty melt. I think I'm gonna get in on that. This song is not about patty melts as much as that. I think I would like that. This song is sort of an old, I'm not really sure how to describe it, but it was popularized by the Carolina Chocolate Drops. A song called "Cornbread and Butter Beans." I need to write a song about patty melts, though. I never really had that thought.
I think
before.
You like them because your name is Patty. Yeah.
You think that's what it is? There's something going on. I think you have solved that mystery. I'll see if I can get someplace to do a signature one that's just a pat melt. Not sure exactly how it's different. Maybe double. I don't know.
checks that's bound to be unliable. Silk clothes for the homes is just a waste of money. Come with me and stay with me and say, be my honey. Now come with me to your cross table. Ain't that made to make that love long as I may go. Come, come, come to the window. So the time you make a full love and I'm over. Thank y'all so much. I just want to say it took a great deal of effort not to tell the birdie and the corndog story before we did that one. I'm sure a lot of you have heard that story before. She's no longer eating corndogs for breakfast. It's all good. But we, you know, before there was three things that the kids are allowed to have for breakfast in my house. That's cereal, frozen waffles, and oatmeal, all of which relatively easy to make. Come in a variety of flavors, and the kids can have completely different stuff for breakfast. It's fine, it's good. It's all business during the week anyhow, so. Now, somehow, after all that, she's got me making her sausage sandwiches every morning. With cheese, with the bread toasted on the number one setting, with all the crust cut. It's a whole process now. She's just got me trained like a dog. I don't know how it's happened. But corn dogs are no longer on the menu for breakfast. We're gonna do a song we've been playing for a long time, and I always thought that this song was about a battle, which it is, but it's about a little more than that too. This song, "Battle of New Orleans," that we've been playing for a long time, originated as an old time fiddle song. Commemorating Andrew Jackson's victory, the Battle of New Orleans in the War of 1812. And it was the name of the song changed, you know, a couple times throughout its life. And then a school teacher, a history teacher by the name of Jimmy Driftwood in Northwest Arkansas got a hold of it and wrote lyrics to the fiddle song melody to sing to his class. I guess that was kind of his thing. And he wrote hundreds and hundreds of songs. But he'd write songs about the topic of the day and sing the songs to the kids to get them more interested in it. And Johnny Horton got a hold of the song and recorded it and had a, you know, huge Billboard success with that. And it wasn't until much later on in my life that I realized that the Kay family settled in the state of Missouri in the year 1816. And one of the things that happened after the Battle of New Orleans was that the soldiers that fought in that particular collection of folks weren't necessarily regular soldiers. They weren't getting paid, unlike the soldiers elsewhere. It was the most decisive victory that we had in the war. It also happened after the peace treaty was signed, which neither side was aware of. But Jackson was heralded as a hero. The government decided, well, we need to pay these people just like everybody else. And they didn't have money, but they did have a whole bunch of land. So everyone who fought in that battle was compensated by way of receiving 120 acres of land in, what I understand, was mostly Missouri. So that tells me this whole area was originally populated by veterans of that particular battle. And my family came by a piece of land that they had in Jamestown, Missouri in the year 1816 the exact same way. So we've been playing this song for years, and it's actually the story about how my family came to be here in Missouri, which I think is pretty cool. So this is the Battle of New Orleans. I should have been tuning the whole time I was talking. squandered all of my time. Folks, you can't play a show in a barn in Missouri and not do a song about Big Smith. It'd just be wrong in all kinds of ways.
Thank you.
not so much. That was a Steve Earle song. Despite the years and years, decades and centuries of rich Celtic music tradition in Ireland, leave it to a guy like Steve Earle to write the number one bar song, number one pub song in Ireland. We're going to do one more song here. It is getting to be about Critter 30. We're going to do another Critter song, and we're going to take a break for a few minutes, and we'll be right back. But I just want to, again, thank you all so much for coming tonight and hanging out with us. It's a special night to us in a lot of different ways. I also want to remind you, we've got some merchandise over there. There's some things called, I believe they're called compact discs. If you or anybody you know or love has a device that plays those things, we've got some of those over here with some music on, some to play tonight. If you don't have a CD player, they make wonderful coasters. They're really colorful. One that's kind of part of like business on top and party in the back sort of thing going on there, I think. We got that. We got some t-shirts and hats and all kinds of other goodies over there. So.
Like,